Hey everybody, Dr. Guy, and I'm on fire today. This is my second video that I've actually recorded today. This is a good sign, especially considering it's so late in the afternoon. And I'm so excited that you're here about this. I don't know if you're as excited as I am that you're here about this video of how to choose a theoretical framework. And a theoretical framework is the key to quickly finishing your dissertation. It's the second key, actually. The first key is writing an amazing, and let me say it a different way. The first key is undertaking an amazing literature review, doing a real literature review. And I have a video about that at thedissertationmentor.com. It's this late. Number two, the second key is having an amazing theoretical framework. The thing I want you to know most is that you can't simply study what you think you're going to study without a theoretical framework. You can't. It would be like me walking into this room without glasses. Now, I can do that. I'm going to bump into things. But at the same time, really, to focus everything, to have, to understand exactly what your study is trying to get at, what's needed is a lens. And that lens is a theoretical framework. You're going to love this video. Because chances are, if you're writing a dissertation, you have felt lost from time to time, and you feel like if there was just some kind of map that you could go through, you would understand what you would do. And this video is a map towards doing this aspect of your dissertation. Now, if you've not seen my other videos, and you know, you're not feeling solid about your purpose statement, your problem statement, your methodology, things like this, I would recommend stopping this video and going and signing up for my other videos at thedissertationmentor.com, or if you're seeing this somewhere else, look for evidence of some other videos by me and see what's possible, because there's some other videos that could benefit you first. If you don't know me, I am Dr. Guy, and the number one thing I love to do with my time is spend time with my family and my beautiful bride. And the reason why I bring this up is to say that if you're watching this, you're probably taking away from life to work on your dissertation. And so it makes me a little bit emotional to say that I feel like you making any progress on this is giving you back a major piece of your life. And so, or allowing you to move on to the next stage. So that's why you're here, is watching this video. It's going to be so tempting to skip something, to fast forward. And what's going to keep you from doing that is that if you watch this video and you follow the steps that I talk about, you are going to make progress. And I'm so happy that you're here. I can say this because I have lots of experience. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this, but just to say that I've worked on many dissertations and I know what I'm talking about. So enjoy. So step one, what is a theoretical framework? In general, a study looks at something specific about a specific person, organization, or locale. It looks at a specific thing at a specific place within a certain context at a certain time. And it's very specific, as you can gather from that sentence. So, but that's not enough. It's not enough to have an amazing purpose statement like I just talked about in one of my other videos. Really, what it's all about is naming a specific lens that you will be wearing while you're undergoing your study. So an example of this is, you know, let's imagine we're doing a study where the purpose statement is something like this. And this is what a great purpose statement sounds like. The purpose of this qualitative case study is to examine the leadership approaches of CEOs in their first 5 years in this position at a publicly held top 10 Fortune 500 company in the United States, or held at top 10 Fortune 500 companies in the United States in 2015. So notice how specific that is. We know the who, we know the what, we know the where, and we know the how, and we know the when. And just notice that we could really engage in this study in a number of ways. We can engage in this study through a feminist lens. Now, I don't know a lot about the feminist lens. I haven't used it in many studies myself, but to say that I imagine we're talking about power, we're talking about dominance, we're talking about gender issues, of many kinds. There's many different frameworks within feminist theory, feminist lens. But to say, imagine, think about the flavor of this study if we were studying through a feminist lens. Like, what would be, what would the results of the study probably feel like as we were going, as we were seeing them? Think about a minority discourse lens or critical race theory, you know, dealing with aggression and power and white privilege. Think about how that would change the flavor of this same study. Just, it's totally a different lens. Think about Ken Wilber's All Quadrants, All Levels, the AQUL lens. If you don't know what that is, basically it just is, it's pretty complicated, but to say that there's four ways, it's actually quite simple, actually, come to think of it, but it's four ways of looking at something, and then it can get more complex if you wish it to. But to say that, you know, if you were looking at something in four different ways, you know, something about like the personal inside me, the external outside me, the outside us, the inside us, those all would have different flavors to them. So just to say that whatever lens you do choose is going to have a massive impact upon what types of questions or what types of things you're doing to collect data. And it's a horrible way for me to put that. Things we're doing. Let me put it this way. Let's say you're doing an interview. How do you know what questions to ask? Do you just make them up? Well, the theoretical lens of your study is going to probably help define what you're asking your participants, if you're asking participants anything. If you're looking at data, like just raw data, some like data points in a table, numbers, how do you choose which numbers to look at? Again, a theoretical framework defines that for you. This is a great example. So, I mean, we talked about, for example, you know, let's say we're doing this study about looking at the leadership approaches of CEOs in the first 5 years of their work at Fortune 500 companies, top 10 Fortune 500 companies. We could choose a theoretical lens like, you know, Bass's full range of leadership model. And if you don't know the model, that's no problem. But just to say is that when we look at something through that model, what we get, the output of that, is we see three things. We see three options. We see, and not exclusive options always, kind of varying degrees of transformational, transactional, and laissez-faire styles of leadership. So when we look through this study through that lens, we get narrowed down to some very specific types of ways of seeing, right, this study, the results of the study, the data of this study. Another example, you know, same study, but we are utilizing the critical race theory theoretical framework. And I'm really oversimplifying here, but some of the outputs of that are issues around the issues of storytelling about white privilege and microaggression. And whether or not you know what those each one of those mean, it doesn't necessarily matter at this point. But just to say is that if you're using this type of theoretical framework, notice again the output changes. It's the same study, but the output changes depending on what theoretical framework you use. Here's a final one. I mentioned the AQUL theory. And, you know, again, we look at the I, the it, the we, the its things, and quadrants, things. It is late in the day, right? The output becomes these four different things. So I'm on a roll here, guys. So just to say that your theoretical framework really defines what the output is of your study. And so the next step then is to really, truly engage in a lit review. And engaging in a lit review is different than writing a literature review. If you've seen my other video about how to engage in a lit review, I go into many different steps about what it truly looks like to delve into the literature and to live there. And I highly recommend you check that out. You have to do lots of reading. Now, a bar that I set for most of my candidates is that you collect 25 quotes a week. That is 5 quotes times 5 sources every single week. So that way, you know, by the end of 10 weeks, you have 250 quotes. By the end of 20 weeks, you have 500 quotes. And By doing that, you're getting deeper into the literature. You're cataloging what you're getting. Don't go and do that without first looking at my instructions about how to do that. I highly recommend you take a look at that video first. But just to say is that when you do that for real, and you know if you haven't, what you'll do is you'll start noticing that certain theoretical frameworks are being mentioned in the research. And I want you to pay special attention to that. Pay attention to the theoretical frameworks, the theories that are mentioned in the literature. That's such a critical piece because that will help you in deciding which theoretical framework to utilize. I want you to make a list of those. I want you to make a list of all the theoretical frameworks that are mentioned in the literature as you're studying them. And I want you to make sure you write down the dates, like for when that study was conducted. So let's say the study used critical race theory and the study was done in 2004. But also, I want you to write down the date of when that theory originated and when that theory, you know, perhaps went out of style. What is the name of the chief author who is known for that framework at that point of time? So you're writing down some very key information about the use of that theoretical framework. You need to examine the merits of each. And here are some questions to help you through that process. You know, which one speaks to you? Which theoretical framework really matches your worldview? Now, I guess some caution on that is that naturally, not every theoretical framework that any dissertation writer will select will be matching their worldview. In fact, it's good sometimes to challenge your worldview. Yet, I do think that you want to choose a theoretical framework that you think works. And specifically, it should be one that's newer, not one that's dated. Some of the theoretical frameworks that I've mentioned don't have a modern, contemporary application. They don't have an application today. And that can lead to some problems. If you write your dissertation based upon a 30 or 40 year old model, that the framework that's 30 or 40 years old, that can really cause a problem. You might have to rewrite a significant portion of your study because you've used a model that is simply outdated. Is it the most widely used one that's now? It doesn't have to be the most widely used, but again, if it's more widely used, chances are there's more material that you could find about this framework. And does it deter away from the usual ways of looking at the issue that you're examining? Sometimes that's a good thing. Sometimes that's not. And is it visual? And here's the thing. In my opinion, if it's not a visual framework, if it can't be drawn, don't select it. And the reason why is because visual frameworks tend, at least in my own brain, to make a lot more sense than just textual paragraph form frameworks. We should be able to see in some way how the different parts relate to one another. Now, there are some great frameworks out there that cannot be drawn, so I don't want to lump all those in there, but I do want to say, try to find a theoretical framework that has some kind of visual component to it. Flip through the books about it, and you'll see some pictures. Stop there and see what they're talking about. You need to choose one. You want to choose one that has clearly defined terms that has been extensively used. And by clearly defined terms, what I mean is that when it lists the parts of that theoretical framework, you should be able to understand what each of the parts are. You want to choose a theoretical framework that has exceedingly well-defined terms. And what this means is that it specifically lists every single piece of the framework. Like, let's say, for example, like with Ken Wilber's Aqual theory, there are lots of parts of that theory. But in the most basic form, there are four quadrants in that theoretical framework. And if you look at the literature, especially Ken Wilber's stuff, it's extensively defined. I mean, there's no question about what each one of those pieces are. You want to make sure you select a framework that has that level of specificity. You want to make sure it's well used in research, that it's not some weird fringe theory that really doesn't have any application for your study. You want to make sure it has a drawn component, like I mentioned. And really, a theoretical framework can be as complex as you want it to be, so choose well. Choose one that will yield the results, that the detail that you're looking for, the one that will help with that problem statement, and that is fulfill your purpose statement too. But you don't want to select one that's so complex that it's just simply not doable, or one that's just not complex at all and frankly is not going to allow you to write the big dissertation that you're having to write to finish off this doctorate. You do want to select one that speaks to your worldview, one that you agree with, one that either challenges you or one that fits for you, one of those. Not one that you're bored about. Don't select something that bores you. Select something that is you're passionate about. And my greatest hope is that a book has been written about your theoretical framework. And the reason for that is that if a book has been written about it, it's probably established enough that it's something usable as long as it fits all the other requirements that we've mentioned. And you can go back, of course, in this video and take a look at those requirements. You will return to this video, I have a feeling. The final step is to buy and read about 5 books, major books on this theoretical framework. Now, if you cannot find 5 major books, then chances are this is probably not the theoretical framework for you. Or at least there should be 5 books that at least mention it and utilize it. Why books? Well, a book is a lot more difficult to publish than an article. So if a publisher went out of its way to publish something about this, chances are it's pretty well established. What I want you to do is read through those books and answer these 5 questions. I'm not going to read through these questions, all of them, but just to say is that you should be able to define very clearly what this theoretical framework is, what are its parts, and you should be able to communicate that really clearly and really simply to anyone that asks. So that's the basics of getting a theoretical framework, and I hope that this video served you. Please, if you like this video, hit that like button. If you think that I have gone wrong, or if you have some questions that you'd like me to answer, please do leave something in the comment field. If an email brought you here, you can always reply to that email. But I would love if you could engage here in the comments field below, so that way we can get into a conversation about this topic, because I want to serve you in any way that I can. And I hope this video has served you. I hope you have a great night. Best wishes.